The IndyCar season is about to begin, and with that thought in mind, we welcome you to a special edition of Speed Week. I'm Bob Jenkins.
And I'm Larry Neuber. In the next half hour, we'll update you on what has happened in early season IndyCar testing, tell you about the changes from last year, and give you predictions from drivers and experts on who they think will win this year's car championship.
And we begin with winter testing. The 87 Marches and Lolas have been undergoing on-track testing since shortly after the first of the year. One of the first tests resulted in a crash and raised concerns about rear wings. This rear wing on Ari Leyendijk's March disintegrated during a Phoenix test, virtually destroying chassis number 001. Mario Andretti was also victim of a rear wing problem at Laguna Seca in his Lola. But Mario returned later to run about a half second under his own track record there. Andretti is in a Lola again this year, but power will come from the Ilmor Chevrolet engine. Two other teams will go with the Ilmor. Pat Patrick's drivers, Kevin Kogan and Emerson Fittipaldi, will have Chevy power in their Marches. And the Roger Penske team plans to campaign the entire season with the Ilmor in the new Penske chassis. Michael Andretti has tested his new March at Indianapolis. Visually, the March has been changed little. Although the car has a lower center of gravity and is lighter, about the only noticeable change is the round roll bar. The pyramid of last year is gone. Al Unser Jr. has switched from Lola to March for 1987. Last year, he finished fourth in the final point standings and was first in class as he was the top Lola point getter. By the way, Lola won only 3 of 17 races in 1986. This didn't seem to matter to defending car champion Bobby Rahal. He switched from March to Lola despite the fact that a March carried him to a record-tying 6 wins last season. The new Lola, fast on the road courses, has been fast on the super speedways as well. Rahal cranked an unconfirmed 215 in practice at Indy. The Roger Penske team wanted to campaign full-time its own PC15 chassis last year. Well, now the latest Penske chassis is ready, and Rick DeBruhl has that story.
For the Penske team, this year's PC16 is more than just another car. For the last few years, Roger Penske has gone with whatever car worked best. If his own car wasn't winning, well, he'd take whatever else would. Andy Sullivan's Indy victory came in a Marge. So did Rick Mears' last Indy win. But this year, the team has committed to the PC16. There are no spare cars sitting in the wings.
I think you're going to see, you know, we're just going to stay strictly committed to these, and I think that kind of effort that we're going to be able to put in, the extra manpower and everything else, by only having one car and engine combination, is really going to be a benefit to us this year.
The car is by no means radically different, but it is 3 inches narrower than last year's, which was already slimmer than the March and Lola.
The car feels pretty good so far. It's the first really good test we've had on it, and we're already quicker than we were with the 15. We're in the 21s, 21.7 or so, and I feel like there's more left in the car. So that's about the numbers that most of the guys have been turning with the March and Lola, other than the last 2 times that Mario and Michael's been out. They've been a little quicker, but it's close.
But testing has not gone smoothly. The first time out, a suspension part broke. The resulting crash put the only car out of commission and pushed back the testing schedule.
Well, I don't think it's really hurt the season. It, you know, we could be a little bit farther ahead, but we're already farther ahead than we were last year.
Now the only question is whether it's far enough. In Phoenix, I'm Rick DeBruhl reporting for Speedway.
Roger Penske began working with the Chevrolet Motor Division in 1985 on a new racing engine developed by two former Cosworth employees, Mario Illion and Paul Morgan. The Ilmor is new, but it's based on an old idea. The Cosworth motor that is currently used in IndyCar racing is a derivative of the Formula One engine that saw great success in Formula One in the mid-60s. The IndyCar Cosworth engine first appeared in 1975. Then up to 80 inches of boost was allowed compared to today's 48.
The Ilmor package just basically represents a new approach at what the package for an IndyCar engine should be based on the rules as they exist now. It's probably a little smaller, a little tidier, and it takes into account that we're running 48 inches now, not 80 inches. And therefore, it's again, nothing extremely new, but it's an update in a package that has been developed in accordance with our current rules.
You know, Bob, Rick did set a closed course record with that engine at Michigan last year, 233.
That's right. It has not won a race yet, but there is no question the engine is fast. The question is reliability. With the kart season ready to kick off in Long Beach, here's a look at Speed Week's top 10 teams and how they might fare this year. Bobby Rahal will again campaign for True Sports, but this year it's a Lola Cosworth. He's the defending kart champion, and the question is, can he change chassis and repeat as champ? Michael Andretti will drive the Craco STP March Cosworth. His new baby boy will further his maturity, and March's record will help. Rick Mears will be in one of Roger Penske's PC16 Ilmor Chevys. The chassis-engine combination may need more time. Danny Sullivan will be Mears' teammate again in similar equipment. An improved record on ovals would help greatly. Al Unser Jr. will carry Team Shearson colors. A Lola loyalist for 3 years, this year it's a March. The new combination may prove to be a hot one. Mario Andretti's Newman Haas team has been the Lola factory team for 4 years. New team members Adrian Newey, Tyler Alexander, and Mario's patience may pay off. One of Pat Patrick's drivers will be Kevin Cogan. The car engine combination will be March Ilmor. A poor second half of 86 may have caused hunger pains. His teammate will be Emerson Fittipaldi. Same car, engine, and sponsor as Kevin. His intelligence and smooth style will help. Roberto Guerrero joins a revamped team headed by Vince Granatelli. He'll drive a March Cosworth. A win early could see him in contention for the title. Tom Sneba has control of the curb March Cosworth. It'll be Buick power at Indy. He led points early last year but needs to sustain a full season. Johnny Rutherford has the same team as last year and same car engine combination. If the season were all ovals, JR would be tough. Team Gallus will go with Jeff Brabham in a March powered by a Honda engine. 1987 will surely see Jeff's first win.
A few new drivers will try their hand at IndyCar racing this year.
Frank Garciero moves his ARS champion Fabrizio Barbaza from a side entree to a main course, and he could be solid. Dick Simon, who makes a habit of experimenting with new dishes, has Ludwig Heinrath Jr. for the whole year, probably. And the latest, Willie T. Ribbs. Yeah, apparently that means no NASCAR, but certainly leaves open SCCA and IMSA. Also guaranteed for this year's bill of fare, Bob Tullius' protege, Chip Robinson. They have a Penske March and will run four races. And Didier Taze, the latest True Sports appetizer. They will run ARS for him. And he has an 86 Lola that Unser Jr. ran last year for kart with another team that has Formula Atlantic experience. They'll try Long Beach, and from then, we'll see. And Steve Millen, he may be America's busiest driver, that is next to Bobby Allison. He gets an Indy rookie test with Hemelgarn Racing, and from there, no promises yet. And an entry for Indianapolis has been filed for two-time winner Gordon Johncock. Gold Racing, backed by a money-based management company, has Daryl Sapi as chief mechanic, as everything stands right now. And in the potential desserts this year, the serving of Porsche and Ferrari for the first time on an Indy table could make this a year of significant IndyCar feasting.
Rookie Jeff McPherson will team with Jeff Brabham and Gallus Racing, and we hear that Formula Atlantic driver Scott Goodyear will drive the Genesee Beer Wagon on road courses beginning at either Portland or the Meadowlands. Dominic Dobson was last year's Rookie of the Year, but no rookie driver contested all the races.
Well, that's a look at some of the new teams and drivers for this year. Now a look at a couple of veterans who may not be involved. Back in 1966, a new chassis called the Eagle made its debut in IndyCar racing. There were six Dan Gurney-built Eagles in the starting field that year at Indianapolis. In 1973, 21 of the 33 Indy starters were in Eagle chassis. Last year, an Eagle did not make the 500, but did run five kart races. However, lack of money may ground the Eagle this year.
We're trying to work out something with the Machinist Union. We have done a lot of work in the wind tunnel, and we feel we have a car that looks very good, and we've learned some things of why we were so poor at Indy last year. We still haven't managed to put together a full-fledged effort, though, but we do have all the necessary stuff for making a car.
Another notable driver missing is Al Unser Sr. Al is the all-time IndyCar money winner with a little over $4.8 million and is second only to A.J. Foyt in the category of Indy starts. But at the moment, Unser, the 1985 kart champion, does not have a ride.
15 races are on the 1987 kart schedule, 9 on road courses and 6 on ovals. The less than a mile Sanair trioval in Canada will long be remembered for this crash involving Rick Mears. The incident severely injured Mears' feet and legs and put him out of racing for nearly a year. Since its inception, kart has tried to keep a balance between the road course races and the oval races. The oval in Sanair in Canada will not be on the 1987 kart schedule, but there will be a new track. It's called Pennsylvania International Raceway. It's here in Nazareth, Pennsylvania. Nazareth will also be a trioval configuration, 1 mile in length. A unique aspect of the new track will be a warm-up lane.
You know, when you go to a mile racetrack, you went to Sanair, you go to Milwaukee, you go to Phoenix, when the drivers are warming up, they're warming up down in the groove. We have a separate warm-up lane throughout the whole racetrack where you're going to be able to warm up, so a driver can be running at 150 miles an hour in the groove, and he's not worrying about a guy that's warming up. That's what happened to Rick Mears, how he got hurt. And I just, it made such a dent in my mind. I said, we can't have guys warming up out on the racetrack when they're running at top speed.
16,000 permanent seats from the old Nazareth track will be complemented by several thousand temporary seats. Right now, construction crews are concentrating on the pit and infield areas. Tom Watson is general manager and believes the track will require both oval and road course skills.
I think it probably resembles the road course primarily because the elevation changes in it. Also, they have decreasing radius turns as well as standard radius turns, so I think it's going to be a very unique track for these people to drive.
You're entering into turn three, turn four. There's a downhill enter. There's a 34-foot elevation change between this location right here. As we climb back out of it, approach the start-finish line, we'll have completed one lap of Pennsylvania International Raceway.
Watson hopes to have the new surface ready for testing by April 15th, shortly after the race at Phoenix.
On the 87 schedule, a couple of ovals that traditionally had two joined Milwaukee and now have only one, Phoenix and Michigan. Added a special non-points event, the Marlboro Challenge, for this year's pole and race winners just before the Miami finale in November.
Is about to enter its ninth year of sanctioning IndyCar races. Its achievements and successes are impressive. But drivers, journalists, and those close to the sport agree, as with any successful business, there are growing pains and criticisms. One item most talked about is the so-called franchise system. The 24 teams accumulating the most points from the previous season can buy a franchise for an amount set by the board of directors in the neighborhood of $60,000. The franchise guarantees a team $7,000 just to practice for a race.
They've built a problem, and that is they've created a franchise plan. They've said that so many teams, 24, are going to receive compensation at every event that they appear. But they've limited it to 24 teams. So the question is, if Bob Jenkins and Paul Page suddenly come into an inheritance of a couple million dollars, we're going to build a racing team, and we can't get into the franchise, then why should we race kart, other than maybe Indianapolis?
When you're missing out on that $7,000 a race, it hurts, although, you know, generally $7,000 doesn't make or break you, but for a small team, that would help us a lot.
To raise the franchise to 30, that means that we either got to get a substantial increase in the amount of money that we get from promoters and elsewhere, or we got to dilute what is already there. And as I said before, I think that you got to get down to the basics, and we got to say to ourselves, do we want 24 strong teams, or do we want what we had 10 years ago, three or four strong teams and maybe 20 or 25 teams that didn't have a chance to win and were not well financed. So I tend to opt to have 24 strong teams.
Even with a franchise, it's sometimes tough for the underfinanced team without a major sponsor to travel great distances to events and make ends meet.
It's a catch-22 problem, where if you're a small team and you don't have the money to run up front, obviously you're not going to attract the big buck sponsors. And the big buck sponsors that do have the money to run up front, they just attract more money.
I think that that's a typical statement that someone might say, but remember, there's no one has a chain on anyone that says you can't go knock on a door to get sponsorship. You know, my costs are higher, I need more sponsorship. I pay my drivers more, I've got to get more sponsorship.
Another criticism. When kart began in 1979, only three of the 18 races were on road courses. None was here in the U.S. This year, of the 15 events, 9 will be on road courses or temporary circuits.
I think oval racing is American, and I sure would hate to see it dwindle anymore.
CART is now run by a lot of lawyers who are good business people, evidently, but they have no sense of tradition, they have no heritage, and I don't think they really care who drives the cars. Maybe that's not important. To me, it is, and I think to people that pay money to races, it is.
To me, that is not an issue anymore on whether or not there's 20% foreign drivers. And whether they come from Germany or whether they come from Detroit and Warren, Michigan, Chevrolet, I think I want them to come from both places.
Despite its growing pains and criticisms, CART IndyCar Racing, including the Indy 500, was the leader in per-race attendance in the U.S. in 1986, according to Goodyear figures. And a USA Today poll found that of 18,000 people surveyed, 27% listed IndyCar Racing as their favorite kind of racing.
So everything points to a tremendous season, and as I've often said, I think the only, if we can keep from blowing ourselves up, I think that we're gonna have a great, great year.
So far in this program, we have talked mostly about the coming season, but the 1986 CART season saw 8 different winners, 2 for the first time, and a championship that went right down to the final event.
Kevin Cogan, the year's first, he had a Greg Foster burst from the blocks and was hurdling everything in his path, winning the opener at Phoenix and almost winning the Indy 500. But Kevin's season deteriorated from there, but he may be poised for even more improvement. None of the newer and younger drivers made a louder statement than Michael Andretti. Seemingly a potential winner every race, he did win 3, both on ovals and road courses, led more laps than anybody, and could have won the PPG crown by beating Bobby at the season finale, but the car broke, stealing his chance. When Michael won at Long Beach, the second race of the year, he just barely nosed out Al Unser Jr. Jeff Brabham was third, prompting the second generation racers to proclaim, "Enter the young." Well, that was the closest Unser Jr. would get until the final race, when another star of the future, Roberto Guerrero, had one robbed from him. He dominated, headed for his first win, but his machine too failed on the final lap, and Al Jr. salvaged his only victory of the year. Third place in points, Danny Sullivan. He provided most of what bright moments there were for Roger Penske, a significant off year for the Baron. Sullivan was the main squeeze in one of the more spectacular crunches when he bounced off Michael at Portland. Penske's other driver, Rick Mears, went winless for the first time since 1977. But at Pocono, he easily had the dominant machine until the rear wing broke. Worst-looking crash of the year, Jose Legarza, Mid-Ohio, his own mistake. And despite this grisly scene, only a broken leg, and he recovered sufficiently to race near season's end. Al Unser Jr. loaded one in the truck in pieces for the second year in a row because of rain at Elkhart Lake. That's Raul Boisel with nowhere to go. Raul easily the year's most improved driver. A recap of the winners. Rahal 6, Michael 3, and Mario, his usual competitive self, made the Andretti family total 5, and Danny's 2. Single race winners in addition to Unser and Cogan, Emerson Fittipaldi, and Johnny Rutherford. But it was the year of true sports. Most wins, points champion, winner of almost $1.5 million, and Bobby's first Indy 500 victory, all tainted only by the passing of true sport founder Jim Truman. His presence is remarkably missed, but very much in his own tradition, the show goes on, and very quickly.
Earlier, you met the voice of the Indianapolis 500 and NBC's motorsports expert, Paul Page, and the motorsports editor of the Indianapolis Star, Robin Miller. Both have opinions on who will be CART champion this year.
Bobby Rahal is on a roll and on a high. Feels very good about himself. Michael Andretti's got a brand new son and is going to show off and has a lot of maturity. I mean, boy, did that guy grow in the last year. Mario, the old veteran, really wants to show off some more victories in another championship. Danny Sullivan and Rick Mears, the Penske team, new car, new equipment, starting late. Can't ever count those guys out. And everybody else is closing in. Very few rookies, so a lot of folks know what's happening. I don't want to pick one. I'll tell you, put long odds on anybody you pick. I'd like to see what a Vegas book would do with it.
I think everybody has pretty much conceded that if things go as they have the last couple years, Bobby Rahal will be awful tough to handle. But I kind of like Al Unser Jr. because he's got a march. Mario will be tough because the Chevrolet obviously looks like it's arrived. Once again, the last two or three years, the championship has been a hell of a race, and I think there's probably four or five guys that'll be in it, but I think my early pick would be Al Unser Jr.
Now, here's our special edition trivia question. Who drove the last DGS Offenhauser-powered IndyCar to victory? A, Johnny Rutherford, B, Wally Dallenbach, C, A.J. Foyt, D, Mario Andretti, or E, Gordon Johncock? Bob will have the answer in just a moment.
Here's the answer to our trivia question. E. Gordon Johncock was the last driver to win an IndyCar race in a car powered by a DGS Offey. It was at Trenton, New Jersey on April 23, 1978. It was also the last win for a Wildcat chassis until more than 4 years later.
And what of the drivers themselves? Whom do they think will be champion this year?
I think the teams, particularly the top ones, are getting more and more prepared and more professional every year. And I don't see that this year is going to be any different, so I would say that it's going to be very tough to win this year, and I look for the same people who won last year winning this year.
I think if I don't win it, I think Emerson has got a very good shot at it.
Hey, just throw it up in the air. Obviously, the guy that's on a roll right now and seems to have tested real well this winter is Bobby Rahal.
The top three driver finished a championship last year. I think is one of the top three or top five, like Bobby Rahal and the other top finishers of the championship.
Realistically, the competition, I think, is pretty much what has been known, say, in recent past, as recent as the end of last year. There can always be one or two additions to that list, and you have to be prepared for that.
And what about you, your prediction for champion?
Well, with enormous confidence in Barry Green, Michael Andretti.
And I predict, without question, Mario Andretti.
Well, that's our special edition of Speed Week on the upcoming IndyCar season. I'm Larry Neuber.
And I'm Bob Jenkins. Follow the entire IndyCar season throughout the year here on Speed Week.
This Speed Week special has been brought to you by BF Goodrich TA Radials. We make your car perform. And by Quaker State Motor Oil. New Quaker State with QSX keeps your engine cleaner to last longer.